Over the past 70 years, public housing policy has further disenfranchised the country's poor African American population, failing the very people it was designed to help. In the 1920s and 30s, progressive reformers sought to alleviate the deplorable and overcrowded conditions of the nation's inner-city slums. The Housing Act of 1937 was part of New Deal legislation designed to help the country out of the Great Depression. It allowed for widespread slum clearance and the construction of low-cost, federally subsidized public housing. American cities had always been divided by barriers of class and race, but urban renewal and the construction of the interstate system reinforced these barriers with concrete and steel. During the period of economic growth after the Second World War, many poor white Americans became homeowners and moved into higher income brackets, while their black counterparts, faced with racial discrimination in both the job market and private housing market, had less success attaining upward mobility. Sociologist Kevin Gotham, in his paper Separate and Unequal, states, "Housing data indicates that whites are overwhelmingly the beneficiaries of single-family housing, and that African Americans are often restricted to multifamily projects, conventional public housing units, and deteriorating and substandard housing in the inner cities." As the post-war economic boom faded in the late 60s, many inner-city youths turned to gangs and lucrative drug trade in order to find financial success. During the recession of the 70s, many public housing buildings fell into disrepair. Broken elevators went unfixed, streetlights remained blown out, and the crime rates began to soar. During the crack epidemic of the 1980s, residents of America's public housing projects became caught in the crossfire of the war on drugs. Public housing built to replace the slums had become the new slums, and once again reformers searched for an answer. In 1989, Congress formed the National Commission on Severely Distressed Housing to investigate the viability of the nation's public housing units and formulate a strategy to redevelop all failed units by 2000. The commission found that 86,000 of the 1.3 million public housing units were severely distressed, and that public housing programs were ill-equipped to handle the redevelopment. This new approach became known as HOPE 6. The HOPE 6 program was designed to redevelop distressed projects, provide job counseling, resident support services, and to provide vouchers for residents to leave public housing. Over the past 20 years, the program has enjoyed many successes, in a large part due to a sustained effort by the federal government to monitor its project and adjust its policies. It succeeded in redeveloping many distressed projects, including Chicago's notorious Cabrini Green, and in a return to the architecture of the past, built smaller townhouse-style mixed-income developments in their place. But the true measure of success lies in the fates of those residents displaced by the program. A Richmond, Virginia resident lamented that the housing authority told her, "You'll be the first to come back." But the resident said, "Everything that has been said has been a lie. When they sent me that letter that told me I was not able to come back, I was tore up." Throughout the history of public housing, progressive ideals have been diluted in their translation into the real world. These programs, time and again, have suffered from a neglect to involve the communities they affect, leaving a vital source of input out of the equation. Each new wave of legislation has failed to successfully address the problems of concentrated poverty and residential segregation, often enforcing them on the largely African-American population of the nation's public housing projects.
Searching for everywhere, like a blind man in the dark.